Have you ever monitored the power and temperature for anomalies while testing a gaming PC? Well, this is the key element in the design and engineering of our T500 gaming PC, which is happening right now. Hello and welcome to our crazy channel. This is the part 3 of the T500 build video that has been going on for some time now. In this video, we will discuss and prove that the T500 can withstand our torture test to emerge victorious. Okay, now you understand why we call ourselves crazy. And if you're getting confused by all of this, I want to ask you, did you watch the first two videos, the first and the second videos, to see the birth of the T500? If not, I strongly suggest you watch the part 1 and the part 2 of the T500 series of video, so you would know why this video actually exists. And you will see the challenge we took upon to bring an ultra cheap gaming PC to your doorstep. So now, if you've already done that, let's get into business. In this video, you will see the completion of the OS installation, which we started in the previous video, and you will see updating the BIOS, which is a real scary process for this particular model. You will see why I'm saying that, and you will see how many seconds it takes to really reach to the desktop, the boot test, idle power and temperature usage, how much watts and what kind of temperature it is stable upon, and then we kind of do a basic stability test to see if this PC is kind of okay. That is what we call the heavy load software, and then we do some kind of durability test using the Ada 64, very popular software, Crystal Disk, which is for the disk, and Unigine Heaven, which is for overall PC, especially the graphics. And once this is all successful, we perform the ultra stress test, which is the torture test using the MSI combustor. Now, without wasting your time, let me get started. Normally, the first step I would prefer to do is a proper BIOS update, but on this PC, I have to update BIOS from Windows, so I need the PC to be stable, and this BIOS update is a time-consuming process. I don't want an unstable PC and a crash to occur, which means the motherboard would be gone. So let me bring the PC to a stability first, and for that I need to make sure all the drivers are installed. I'm an old school guy, so what I would do is go to device manager, check each component and their drivers are installed or it's updated. I would go online and update them, which takes a long time, and my friend suggested to use the Snappy driver installer, the SDI. It's an open source software, so can be kind of trusted. Not all open source can be trusted, but this one seems to be okay. I've tried it before. From my experience, the driver is kind of helping me to find the drivers. There were a few drivers missing in this PC, and it's so I found them and it's been installed. You would see that how that's going to happen from this software as we proceed. So the missing drivers are going to be fixed, and then I would manually update some of the other drivers. And most of the time, people miss out on the drivers. The moment the OS is working, they just want to proceed with using it as a normal use or play games and things like that. Sometimes you have blue screen of death, sometimes you have crashes, erratic behavior, performance is not up to the par. Drivers is one of the most crucial component in the Windows, and it has to be done in the right way. That's one of my secrets, because I always make sure the drivers are perfect, and that's the base, the basement of this install. I can guarantee that PC won't have erratic behaviors or weird behaviors in a long time, unless those drivers are corrupted or you install, you know, a software or some update that is going to corrupt the driver. Makes a hell lot of difference, and that's the difference between me and a normal person who sets up Windows. And sometimes people even believe the default drivers installed by Windows is actually the best, and I can guarantee you that is not always the best. Sometimes you just need to install the actual driver from the OEM or the manufacturer, which is better than Windows. And sometimes Windows let the device work, but the performance and the stability will be mediocre. Maybe it's very bad and you would think that the device is not working, but actually it's just the driver. With this discussion, we have completed the driver install, and now I'm installing the BIOS, which actually took 6 long minutes. I'm just compressing the video, making it happen really quick, so you just get to see what's happening with the BIOS update. This is a really scary update because I have never seen a 5-minute long BIOS update. However, we got lucky and we are through with the BIOS update and the system restarted. Now I am in the BIOS. I just checked the BIOS settings. Everything is good. This will be the last time I'm going to enter the BIOS to ensure all the final settings are done as per the way I want it to be. All the unwanted devices will be disabled and the fast boot will be enabled, and I will go through all the settings to check if there is anything else that needs to be done, after which I would save and exit. And then It's time for us to boot and start the real work. First, we need to check the drivers are still there. Because of BIOS update, something is gone. Then we need to check the performance option, set up the swap file, and then we do a boot test and see how long it takes to boot. 16 to 15 seconds is a good. Disable some startup applications, that's going to take the performance out. And then we move on to the performance settings and the power. We enable high performance setting. And then we go into the apps and features, uninstall some bloatware that is sent by Microsoft, after which we go to the website, download the hardware info, and then we install it. Then we install the CC cleaner, which is part of my software package. By the time, I'm pretty sure Windows update would be ready to be completed. Complete the update and restart, that's going to take some time. And after which, when the system boots, install Ada 64, Unity in heaven. Then we have the crystal disk mark, which has to be installed. And then after that, go ahead and restart and check a reboot time, how bad it's after all installing all the latest applications. It's gone almost to 20 seconds. It's not bad. Install the Steam and Epic Games software. Install the afterburner from MSI, which checks the graphics performance. Then we need to set up the Steam library folder path, which is important. And then we need to also set the Epic Game Vault cache, which has to be set up. Now I will install the PC Mark, 3D Mark, and then I will install the Fortnite and Shadow of Tomb Raider, which is the demo version actually. And then we install Doom Eternal. And then we start with the stability test on the heavy load software. It's not extremely load or heavy, it just pushes the PC overall. And then we check the temperature monitor using the hardware info to see how long and how well it performs after 2 hours of stress test. As you can see, the temperatures are pretty stable. Next one would be the Ada 64, which is pretty awesome in my opinion. It can overall stress your CPU and find whether the PC is durable. The temperatures are stable even after 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. It doesn't matter because the build is so good. You can see there is no spike in power or temperature. It's all been stable and there is a continuous rise of the temperature. And after 5 minutes, still it is performing pretty okay. No excessive load. And so we move on to the next one of the durability test, which is a crystal disk mark. We check the SSD and the hard drive performance to see how well they stack or if there is any problem. It would clearly show up here in these benchmarks and the test if these drives have issue. Next one is the Unity in heaven durability test. This is an old software for benchmark. First we do a free run just to be sure the PC is stable, and then we go for the software based benchmark, which will stress the complete components to give us a very good feedback of how well this will perform in a gaming session. Then we check the afterburner and HW info to see how well it performed. Where are the potential bottlenecks? Did it load everything? Did everything max out? So it seems like everything is great. Next one is the MSI Combustor. This is a very tough and stressful software. That's why we call it the stress test, or I call it the torture test, because it really pushes things. Right now we are just running the graphics only. It's like just the graphics. Now we are going to push the CPU burn part, which is pushing the CPU over the normal usage. This doesn't actually happen in normal world usage. You don't get a full CPU and GPU usage same time for games, but still we are trying to see what kind of a load is being placed. You can see the power usage is maxed out and the temperatures are maxed out, but still it's all very stable, nothing out of control. So analysis says that the graph all looks good, everything is maxed out, everything is fully used, but the temperature and the power is stable, which is what our build is all about. In the last 10 minutes, I've shown a lot of things that happened in a very quick session or in a very short time. But actually these things happened over a period of 3 to 4 hours or even more. The downloads and software, the downloads alone was worth 500 GB of data was downloaded just to complete this video. You would understand probably in the next video how this 500 GB of data was downloaded and how it took 3-4 hours, because the basic stability test that we did was the heavy load software test alone took more than 2 hours. We let the PC run on that heavy load software for 2 hours and more. And then we did the durability test. We repeated the durability test of the Ada 64, the Crystal Disk, and the Unigine Heaven 3 times to make sure that these performances were consistent. It's not just by fluke or by just chance I just got a good performance. So these tests have to be repeated, not just to show to you, it's also for our own concern that we are making sure that the product that we are pitching is actually performing as expected. So in this video, let's summarize. You saw the completion of the operating system installation, where we went ahead and installed the drivers, which is very important. And then you saw we are updating the BIOS, a very scary BIOS update. And then we did the boot test comparison, how long it takes the time to boot. You saw the kind of power consumption in idle. It's less than 40 watts. The temperatures are also in 30 to 40 watts on idle. And then you can see the stability test, very stable. The temperatures didn't cross 60 degrees inside the chassis or on the CPU or on the motherboard. And then we did the Ada 64 test, which was really stressful, and the system survived that. We did the Crystal Disk, the Unigine Heaven, and the MSI combustor test, which is actually a Farmark software being used for this one. Okay, so the point is simple. When we put the probes of those temperature meters, one probe is placed beside the CPU and one probe is placed beside the GPU. So that's why you have different temperature readings, two different zones inside the case that we measured to see, okay, you cannot just blindly believe the numbers that shown from the CPU and the GPU. If the inside remains hot and there is no enough airflow in the chassis, especially this is a factory chassis, so if there is no enough airflow, the CPU and GPU over a period of time will overheat. And that's why these tests are concerned or important. If it is just to do one benchmark and then show that everything is great, yes, for that time the benchmark ran in the cool temperature of the room, everything is great. But we continuously ran these tests back to back without letting or allowing the CPU to vent out the hot air unnaturally, like by keeping it open or letting it cool down. We ran the test back to back. So you can see these things will not happen in real life when you run your Excel or PowerPoint or a Word, or you check your email, you browse your web, or even if you play some heavy games. It's all going to be below this kind of performance. The 300 watt PSU that we used, you can see, is barely even touching 150 watts at a peak usage, and it's staying below 50 watts. To be honest, it's actually below 40 watts when the system is idle. It's all great. The design is great. The purpose is exactly what we intended it for. So this is what we want to show in this part 3 video of durability and the stress of our T500. Hope you all enjoyed all the details that we showed so far. And next, in the next video, we are going to show you a in-game benchmark of Fortnite. Then we will show the 3D Mark, and then we will run the Doom Eternal. These are the three main things you need to look out for in the next benchmark video that is coming up. So subscribe and follow us and give us a like for all the hard work we put in this video. I hope you all enjoyed. I'm sorry I cannot put all the videos. It is over 3 hours plus. It has to be shortened to get the details. And in the final 5th video, you would see the scores and the numbers of the system that actually all these tests have brought out in a table, so you know how or what was actually being done. So thank you for watching. We appreciate your time, and I hope you all enjoyed, and you have a wonderful day.